I talk about heat pumps a lot. They really are the most energy efficient way to heat and cool things, but they're not the only way. There's another form of cooling that's been getting a lot of attention in recent years that might just lie in these bendy little wires. It might seem a little abstract at first, but the study of caloric cooling represents the potential for a new solid-state-esque approach to managing heat. And yes, I said solid state. That comes with the possibility of achieving significantly higher efficiencies without refrigerants. Caloric cooling holds massive implications for the way we cool our homes, our vehicles, and maybe even ourselves. So what does this metal have in store for us? How does it work? And why does it have the potential to completely change climate control? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Factor. Now, if you're a regular viewer on my channel, you already know that I hammer on the fact that there isn't a single technological savior that's coming to liberate us all. There's more than one way to overcome the obstacles that are facing us as we progress through this clean energy transition. And here's a new fascinating contender. Now, what I have here are wires made out of nitinol, a nickel titanium alloy or metal mixture. It's also a type of shape memory alloy. Basically, you can remember its shape better than I can remember where I put my car keys. Now, that means it has a really interesting property, the ability to do this. Now, I'm not just showing off nitinol's quirks for fun. And yes, it is very fun. Its unique abilities may one day be the backbone, or perhaps the wireframe, for refrigeration and air conditioning systems that are cleaner and more efficient. So welcome to the world of elastocalorics. You may be wondering, elasto what now? And what does this wire have anything to do with the future of cooling? Well, chances are that you're familiar with the capital C calorie associated with nutrition labels. That's an offshoot of calorie with a lowercase c, the unit that, in the simplest sense, measures heat energy. In other words, heat is the main course on this menu. And with elastocaloric cooling, we're looking at a new way of serving up colder air without relying on refrigerants. Now, this spectrum of solid-state technologies might just become the new and improved way of getting your house or your car or your leftovers to chill out. So how? Well, with the power of what a member of my scientific advisory board called the energy conversions of the future. Now, we're already constantly converting energy in our daily lives, and not just by flicking light switches on and flipping laptops open. Your body turns the chemical energy that you get out of your meat and potatoes into the mechanical energy that gets you through the day. The meat and potatoes of this channel, renewables like wind and solar, are more advanced conversions. Wind's kinetic and mechanical energy, and solar's light and heat are transformed into electricity. As our demand for energy grows, the race is on to find more direct, more efficient, and more safe ways of obtaining it. That means getting creative. And before we dive deeper into elastocalorics, it helps to understand how traditional cooling systems operate. Out of the estimated 5 billion cooling units globally, that includes refrigerators, air conditioners, and heat pumps, most function through vapor compression cycles. Now here's a quick breakdown. Imagine that you're plugging in your fridge for the first time. Its mission is now to get rid of all that hot air inside of it. Now, the refrigerant, often a hydrofluorocarbon or HFC, travels through four main components: a compressor, a condenser, an expander, and an evaporator. Now, step one, the compressor increases the temperature and pressure of the refrigerant vapor. Step two, the condenser changes the refrigerant from a gas to a liquid, which releases a lot of heat into the environment. Now, step three, the expander depressurizes the refrigerant. As it expands, it chills, making it colder than the interior of the fridge. Step four, the evaporator absorbs heat from inside the fridge, vaporizing the refrigerant, and the cycle starts over with the compressor capturing this warm vapor. Although the stars of the show are called refrigerants, this system works in a similar way for air conditioning too. This whole process relies on phase changes in refrigerant properties to transfer the heat. But what if we could avoid refrigerants altogether? So how does this relate to elastocalorics? Well, as it turns out, most alloys have more than one solid phase, which might sound surprising. We usually think of phases as solids, liquids, or gases, but there can be different solid phases too. A good example is carbon. When it forms a honeycomb structure, it becomes graphite, the soft stuff that you have in pencils. But if it's arranged in a tetrahedral structure, you get diamond, one of the hardest materials on Earth. Now, in metal alloys, especially nitinol, two common but harder to picture phases are austenite and martensite. And just like how water absorbs and releases heat when it changes from ice to liquid, these metals do something similar when they switch between austenite and martensite. It's kind of like how refrigerants work in the vapor compression cycle that we use all the time. Now, I don't want to compress too much information at once, but how do we practically replace the gas and liquid in our cooling systems with solid wires of fancy metal? And speaking about cooling things like refrigerators, it's making me think about food. and it seems like now's a good time to take a quick snack break with today's sponsor, Factor. Now, my schedule is so hectic, it's made it challenging to prepare nutritious meals at lunchtime. I was taking shortcuts and eating the easy, not healthy stuff way too often. Factor really helped keep the stress out of planning and preparing what I eat while keeping it nice and healthy. And fun fact, I actually signed up for Factor well before they were ever a sponsor 2 years ago. One of my favorite things is the variety. Factor offers 35 wholesome meals every week to choose from, like Gourmet Plus, Keto, Calorie Smart, or vegan and veggie options. It's easy to find something that you'll love. I'm kind of obsessed with their peanut bootable. Factor isn't just flexible with what you eat each week, but you can pause or reschedule your deliveries at any time. No prep, no mess, never frozen, and it's ready in just 2 minutes. Head to factor75.com or click the link below and use code 50undecided to get 50% off and free shipping on your first Factor box. That's code 50undecided at factor75.com to get 50% off and free shipping on your first Factor box. Thanks to Factor and to all of you for supporting the channel. So how do we use solid wires in our cooling systems? Obviously, we're not going to be running metal through compressors and cooling coils, but caloric cooling cycles can actually be broken down into four steps, just like the vapor compression cycles. It all starts with the material that you're using. For elastocalorics, that could be something like natural rubber, nitinol, or other types of shape memory alloys. Next, you apply force to the material, which stresses it. That mechanical energy turns into internal energy, making the material change shape and heat up. The heat that's generated then flows out of the system, similar to how heat is released in the condensing stage of a vapor compression cycle. That's a high-level explanation of elastocalorics, so let's get down to the wire. Nitinol is super elastic. This means that it can not only shapeshift visually, but structurally. And this phase transformation is completely reversible. It's sort of like an untaped cardboard box is square from the front, but deforms into a parallelogram if you put a little force on it, and then snaps back to place once you remove that force. You can use those same shapes to visualize how nitinol moves between states, but this magic metal goes a step further. Like a student during an exam, nitinol turns into something different under stress. When stressed, it changes phases from martensite to austenite, which causes it to heat up slightly. But when the stress is removed, the material switches back to martensite, and this phase change cools it down. As the stress is released, the wire chills out, pulling heat from its surroundings. And what's interesting about nitinol is something called thermal hysteresis. That's a fancy way of saying that the temperature at which it heats up under stress is different from the temperature at which it cools down when the stress is released. For example, in high-efficiency nitinol, adding stress at 22 degrees Celsius can heat it up to around 49 degrees Celsius, but removing the stress drops the temperature all the way down to 5 degrees Celsius, about 17 degrees cooler than the start. And that's just one wire on a lab table, so we can imagine that with enough wires and the proper design, the wires can remove heat from a space, cooling it off. To be refrigerant clear, like with other solid-state tech, solid-state doesn't mean that there's no liquid or moving parts in this context. While caloric cooling doesn't require refrigerants, you obviously can't pump a solid material through a system. You still need a mechanical input, like the linear actuator, to get things moving. So depending on the design, a caloric cooling system might still need a heat transfer fluid to deliver that freshly cooled air where it needs to go. In fact, some elastocaloric prototypes do use fluids. It's confusing, I know. So let's talk more about those prototypes. If you're like me when I first heard about all of this, I wondered how much progress there's been on trying to make this a reality. It's still a fairly new idea, but the interest is growing fast. Within the past decade or so, the field has jumped in popularity, with more and more publications and prototypes that are emerging. In this bar chart from a 2023 paper, you can clearly see the spike in interest. According to a 2024 review, interest in elastocalorics shot up by 160% between 2017 and 2022. But what's making it such a big deal all of a sudden? Well, elastocalorics are part of a broader group called caloric cooling, where things like electrical, magnetic, and mechanical fields trigger materials to absorb and release heat. Take electrocaloric or magnetocaloric materials, for example. They use special electromagnetic properties to generate or absorb heat under certain fields, which sounds super futuristic, right? There's a catch. They're really tough to control, measure, and actually put to use. Now, elastocalorics work differently. They rely on something much simpler, uniaxial stress, basically pulling or pushing along one axis. And here's the kicker. Elastocalorics perform better than other types of solid-state cooling. They have stronger cooling effects, can save more energy, and can be used in a wider range of applications. As the International Institute of Refrigeration said in 2022, the elastocaloric effect in commercial-grade materials is already outperforming the best electrocaloric and magnetocaloric materials. Plus, shape memory alloys, which elastocalorics are made from, already have an existing market, so we don't have to reinvent the wheel with brand new materials. As of 2022, over 20 elastocaloric prototypes have hit the scene, and you've actually seen some of them in action already. Remember my weird little wires? Well, elastocaloric's hottest shape memory alloy is nitinol at the moment, and it's partly because nitinol isn't just super elastic, it's super accessible. I bought mine on Amazon, and it was commercialized for a multitude of medical applications as early as the 1980s. Now, the last few years have seen multiple nitinol-based prototypes, but it is important to note that they've started small. Like, literally. In a 2022 paper, researchers from Xi'an Xiaotong University and the Chinese Academy of Sciences describe a fully integrated elastocaloric refrigerator. It successfully demonstrates the possibility of designing these devices compactly enough for commercialization. But when the authors say compact, they're not kidding. The prototype has a cooling power of 3.1 watts, which is enough to cover its 0.9 liter compartment. Later that same year, a research team from Saarland University in Germany debuted an elastocaloric demonstrator system characterized by artificial muscles composed of nitinol wire bundles. By 2023, engineering professors at the University of Maryland had developed a device capable of producing 200 watts of cooling capacity, which is enough for certain types of mini fridges, like a wine cooler. As of 2024, researchers at Saarland had built another prototype, a refrigerator with a sufficient capacity for one small bottle. I'm sure you're noticing a pattern here. The prototypes we're seeing for elastocaloric systems are still fairly small. But hey, big things have small beginnings. And don't get me wrong, small-scale applications are pretty much what you'd expect from a lab setting. And yes, there are still some hurdles to overcome. For one, the amount of heat elastoclorics can remove is pretty small, which means that you need a lot of wires and cycles to get the job done. Now, these systems are literally hundreds of years behind the vapor compression HVAC systems that we use today, so there's still a lot of work that needs to be done to optimize them. But there's a huge potential performance-wise. In heating and cooling tech, you often rate the system efficiency with a coefficient of performance, or COP. A heat pump system or refrigerator might have a COP of 3, which means for every unit of electricity that you put into the system, you get 3 units of heat energy back out. It's why they're over 100% efficient, which seems like a physics exploit. Now, I had a chance to speak with Dr. Ichiro Takeuchi from the University of Maryland about their work. He told me that just the material's equivalent efficiency of elastocalorics is around a COP of 20. But you can't directly compare that because it's not a full system. Each component in the system for the final product will eat into that COP performance, which is why he said a final system will most likely be closer to the efficiency of a vapor compression system at the end of the day.
This process is extremely energy efficient. So there's a good chance that if everything is put together, could be competitive in terms of overall efficiency compared to the existing vapor compression technology. When you buy a refrigerator or air conditioner and you talk about COP, that's a system's final product COP. So we are yet to be at a point where we could do one-to-one comparison.
Right.
It's difficult to, we're beginning to be able to do that finally, because after 10, 15 years, we're able to make something that actually resembles a gadget. You know, we have a big machine in our lab, which has enough capacity to be a small scale refrigerator. So now we're beginning to be able to plug it into the wall and then do a one-to-one comparison with vapor compression.
If you'd like to see the full interview with Dr. Takeuchi, where we go in depth into how it works and how efficient these things are right now, be sure to listen or watch my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined. You can find it everywhere you get podcasts like Apple and Spotify, but also here on YouTube. I'll put a link in the description. Another issue is stress fatigue. The more stress on the wires, the fewer cycles they last. But if you lower the stress, there's less cooling. Researchers are working on new alloys and techniques to improve how well the materials convert mechanical energy into heat. Then there's the challenge of applying stress without using tons of electricity. Actuators need to be efficient and compact because nobody wants a fridge that's mostly coils and little space for food. So elastocaloric systems have to be practical in design and footprint. Compared to other alternatives, elastocalorics have a lower technology readiness level, or TRL. And TRL measures how close a new tech is to being ready for the market. NASA came up with it in the 1970s, and it's now used across industries. Since elastocaloric prototypes only started appearing in the 2010s, and the first dedicated conference just happened last year, it makes sense that this field is still pretty early in development. So why even bother with elastocalorics? The reason is simple. No refrigerants means no hydrofluorocarbons, and that's a way bigger deal than you might realize.
The problem is hydrofluorocarbons, as you know, has high global warming potential. So there's need to pursue refrigerants that are not has zero global warming potential.
Even though this technology is not yet mature, shape memory alloys like nitinol could play an important role in reducing the use of HFCs. Also, all big ideas, such as finding an alternative to the cooling systems that we've been using for nearly a century, require small steps to get started. It's still very early days, but this is definitely an area of study that we should be keeping our eyes on. If anything, the transformations are entertaining to watch in real time. But what do you think? Would you be interested in an elastocaloric fridge or air conditioner? Jump into my comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, while we'll keep this conversation going. And thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support. And a big welcome to new Supporter Plus members, Taylor Buslacci and Richard Campbell, as well as producer Michael R. Koch. Hope I didn't butcher anybody's names. Your help really does help to keep this channel going. I'll see you in the next one.